Hello guys, can you hear us? Let's see. Access webinar.
Can you hear us?
Yes, we're live. All right. Okay, guys. So my name is Carlota. Hi.
This is Manon. My name is Manon, and I'm program manager on the bridge.
And I'm Maria, and I'm a developer in School Lab here in International.
And you also did LaBridge.
Yes, I did LaBridge.
Okay, so this is the first time ever that we're doing this. So please bear with us while we try to really understand how it works. So if any of you right now have any questions, so let's see if the chat works. Hello. Right, I'm currently on Google Hangout, so I'm not sure whether it works. So we do have two people with us right now. Guys, anyone else? We might wait a few minutes to see if we're joined by other people. Let's see. What I don't understand is the chat. Because if you're on YouTube, can you chat with us?
I don't think so.
On Google Hangouts. What I don't understand is the chat.
So you do need the Google Hangout.
Stop chat.
What chat?
I saw something.
Oh no, oh my god, where are we?
Okay. No, the other one.
Okay, we're gonna wait a bit longer to see if everyone joins us, and we'll start in a couple of minutes. Let's see. I don't. How do they message us? That's what I don't know.
Maybe on Google Hangouts.
What you can also do is post comments below the video so we see it and we can answer your questions.
Anything on the bridge?
How can I
edit?
Quentin, est-ce que tu peux poser des questions quoi, sur est-ce que tu peux regarder, est-ce que tu peux pour nous poser des questions? All right. Hi guys, we're live here from School Lab. With Maria, alumni from the Bridge,
hi.
And Manon,
hi.
The program manager. We're just figuring out the last few things on how to get to you and how we hear from your thoughts and how you can write to us in order for us to answer you. So we are on Google Hangout as well. I don't know if this is working.
It's not.
Yeah, we're just trying to figure things out, and we'll start in a couple of minutes. Sorry about this.
The compte YouTube.
Okay, so everyone has a YouTube account. Okay, so you need a YouTube account in order to answer a question, in order to post questions. So please don't hesitate, otherwise we are going to start. In any case, you can write us as well on our email, which is lebridge, R-E-L-E, bridge, altogether at theschoolthat.com if you have any questions. Okay, so I think we're going to start. We're not too many people, but that's okay. So basically, the aim of this webinar was for you to be able to ask questions to someone who launched a project in Silicon Valley. That's why we have Maria over here. She's going to be talking about her experience as an entrepreneur in Silicon Valley and what it's like to be a foreigner there and how different is the mindset in the US compared to France, although she's Spanish, so she can also talk about maybe the Spanish mindset. And we're also going to be talking a bit more about our program. So SchoolLab has a set of programs for students and recent graduates. Some of them take place in Paris, and then some of them take place in between two ecosystems, like Le Bridge, which is in between UC Berkeley and Paris. Before anything, you know, I'd like to welcome Maria, and we're really, really happy to have you here.
Thank you so much.
So if you maybe want to tell them about your experience, and don't hesitate to post your comments on below on the comment area so we can see your live comments and answer them. All right, Maria, you can
start. Okay, so I'd like to you to know that I did the last promotion of alumni of Le Bridge. I was in Berkeley for several months.
Four months,
and I came back to Spain first in December, and then I came here. And I started my own venture in France. So my experience as a Spanish person, I was the only Spanish over there, was kind of very rich. I got to know a lot of people from different countries. We had a Chinese over there. We had some people from Morocco. We had French people too. It was great to get to know different profiles and especially different backgrounds. I'm an architect, so when I got there, my business background was quite like, I didn't have that much background in business. So everything I know from like now is what I learned there. And I can say that it was kind
how,
of
yeah, what, why? So tell us a bit more about your background and why yes. did you, why did right I after choose? School, you chose this right. path rather than, you know, getting a job that's well paid and
of course I started thinking about entrepreneurship when I worked. I did an internship in an innovation and research studio in Madrid, and there was my first contact with all of this innovation ecosystem and everything around like Silicon Valley and what they do over there.
At that time when you first encountered that, what did you think?
I thought I had kind of found my place, because I thought from the beginning I thought I wasn't like the regular architect. I didn't want to do what everyone wanted to do. I didn't want to start working for someone for several years and then just try to be better. I knew that architecture wasn't enough for me, so I thought about launching my own venture. And my parents are both entrepreneurs, so I think I have it from
them. Like, yeah,
yes.
You have it in the blood.
That's it. So after that, I thought about like seeing around what was offered, and I found Le Bridge, and I thought.
And why did you think you needed support in that way? Why not just find a partner that you would, you know, you would work with well and you had a common idea? Why did you need that sort of academic background or support?
Because from my background, my architectural background, my knowledge of all the business things is like, I don't have any. So I needed some academic push and like to learn like physical things and like methodologies and stuff to try to improve myself like in that ground. Yes. So
and what about finding a team?
It's kind of difficult when you live in an environment where people are not like you,
uh-huh.
and they prefer to be in a big company or something. So for me, in Madrid, it was kind of difficult to find those people who wanted to do the same things than me. So I didn't find really people as motivated as me in this field.
So you needed to get out of your current environment.
Exactly.
Okay, cool. And so mm-hmm. And so then obviously you found out about Le Bridge.
Yes.
What made you choose this program?
Having the opportunity to be at the core, like in Silicon Valley, where everything started, where everything was created from the beginning, like where the startup concept started. It's like it's a huge opportunity, and saying no to this kind of opportunity is like, you know, not a deal. Yeah, it's an adoption.
So tell us a bit about how your experience went. When you first got there, how did you feel? Is it really true? Like, is Silicon Valley really as special as everyone says?
Yes, and even more than I thought.
Okay.
I already knew some places in the States, so being in the United States wasn't that big deal for me. But really, San Francisco is kind of totally different from every other city or in the States. It's kind of like, it's so cosmopolitan.
Yeah,
cosmopolitan. It's you can find people from everywhere. Everyone is so open to talk, to meet, to like, it's incredible. It's amazing. Like, I didn't expect it that when I got there, and from the beginning I felt kind of at home because everyone was so open. And
so it was easy to meet, let's say if you were working on a food tech project.
Yes.
Was it easy to meet the people behind projects that were already running? And if yes, how did you get in touch with those people?
Yes,
because it
of course.
Seems a bit crazy over here to think, okay, I'm gonna get in touch with the CEO of Deliveroo, and you're like,
This is one of the big points of this program, is that you learn to how to lose the fear of like contacting someone like you think is like, oh my god, he's a great,
yeah,
like,
he's never gonna have
yes,
time to
exactly. And you see that in the United States, it's so common to meet with especially with students, because they want to share what they know, they want to mentor, and they want to share the knowledge with people who are motivated and who want to do things, and especially who want to try to launch something.
Perfect.
So yes.
And so how did you get in touch with like CEOs and stuff, like through LinkedIn or events or
Berkeley was a big point of contact, because when you're a student in Berkeley, it's like your doors are totally open to meet everyone. But especially, yes, LinkedIn was a tool that we used a lot. And then even email and phone. Just
oh, really?
Yes.
You were just
calls,
calling up people?
Yes,
and
yes. Yes, and
okay,
maybe FaceTime too, independent, but and even in meetups, when we went to meetups and we met, we tried to talk to as many people we could. So to try to have this first contact with them and then have a more private or more specific meeting after.
Okay, I see that some people are connected and they're saying hi on the chat. So I'm Carlota, by the way, so I'm the one answering your questions. So yeah, you know, don't be shy if you have any questions or any questions for Maria, please, you know, shoot. Otherwise, I'll continue asking her questions. So just a bit, a few little reminder to those who just arrived. So this is a webinar on looking back at Maria's experience, who launched a project at UC Berkeley for 4 months, coming from an architectural background, so she had no baseline whatsoever on business. Then she found a team, which is the next topic, and then launched a first project, and now came back to Paris here at School Lab to work on something else. And so, yeah, we were just talking about how she met that many people, because everyone says that in Silicon Valley it's so easy to meet anyone slash everyone, right? So I was asking her how she actually did it and was it really true, and her answers were yes, basically. And she met people through meetups, obviously having the Berkeley stamp on her email or on her business card really helped. It really opened doors in terms of contacting people through LinkedIn or even straight on the phone. So going back to what you were saying earlier, so you guys arrived, you had maybe a few learning expeditions whatsoever and got to feel what was cooking in a way in Silicon Valley. And then how did it all happen? Like, how did you get to meet people that you thought, oh, you know, I would be totally okay working with those people?
The team.
Like, yeah, how did you?
It was kind of hard. I remember that part as the hardest one, because it's not always easy to
find a right partner.
Exactly, but it was great having the experience, because especially me, I switched twice. So, and let's say the last time I met, like the last team I was in was really the good fit. So I was
Why was it a good fit?
Because even though we were completely different, we were so complementary, and everything he liked or he loved, I was like kind of worse on those points, and the contrary too. So it was great. He has a more like Sciences Po, more business background, more like developer. He had done like coding.
Yeah.
Yes. And I was more like design and more like public relationships, partnerships, and more like finding collaborations. So we kind of the last point was like.
And why didn't it work with your previous team?
Because I love the topics we started, but finally, let's say it was kind of difficult to find the right way. I was more autonomous, and some of my partners wanted more like to work all the time at the same place, like to be everyone together all the time. And that wasn't kind of my way of doing things.
Okay, so you had differences in terms of ways of working.
Exactly.
What about vision? Because we hear a lot that people split because they don't have the same vision, or they don't want to take the project or the product towards the same place. Was it also the case
for you? That was the second,
you?
Yes. The first reason was a way of working, and the second point was kind of the big deal with the vision. As I'm an architect, my vision was more like based.
Vast?
Yes.
Like, you look at the bigger picture?
Yes, exactly. And let's see, I wanted to do a project in phases, in different phases. And my point was to do a big project, and others wanted smaller things. So finally I decided it wasn't the best fit for me, and I started looking for all the teams. There were
Did you experience it as a failure though? Like the fact that you were with a team that wasn't really working? Did you question yourself? Did you say, oh, is it me? Or how did you live it?
Of course. It was kind of hard to get to decide to split, for example. But finally I think that, you know, in the deep of yourself, you know what's the good decision to make. So I knew it. I knew I had to change, and I knew that we weren't like completely complementary. So it wasn't a failure for me. It was a great experience. I got to know different profiles I didn't met after that, and I didn't work with, like engineers, and we had a medical science
student,
yes. So I don't know, they were profiles I would never have chosen from the beginning, for example, and having the chance to work with them, even though it wasn't the last
the
team,
right,
yes, it was awesome.
And do you have a question?
Do you want to continue on Berkeley part, or can we go on the Paris part too?
Yeah, we'll get into. I just had one more question.
Yes, of course.
And so finding the team, did you find a mentor when you were at Berkeley? And if yes, how did you manage it? Because I feel a lot of people, when they're starting a project or they start having an idea, they're a bit lost, so they don't really know where to start or whatever. So having someone mentoring you, having someone giving you ideas on which path to take or who to meet, I feel is a lesson. So did you have that chance?
I didn't meet my mentor there.
Okay.
I met him in Spain before, and in my specific like team, we had not mentors, but we had all the Berkeley staff that was pretty helpful, and that was like, they were completely like able to help us whenever we wanted, like complete disponibility for us. So let's say even like Berkeley stuff, like Mark and
the other professors.
Yes, the other professors.
Okay.
We were all the time in contact with them, so yes.
And if you were to think of one person or one moment that sticked with you throughout the time at Berkeley, even after Berkeley, what would it be? That one thing that was really, that you said, wow, my life, you know, or I'm kicking ass, or something that, you know, you were like, I'm proud of you. I'm proud of myself.
I can say it was a failure experience.
Okay.
It was a failure experience, but I'm so proud of it, because we got to like, we kept with the idea until the best, like,
So tell us about it. What was it?
We wanted to organize an event because our venture was related to meetings and events and like networking and stuff. We got to have a space to have this event. We had like the persons who were,
you had speakers, you
yeah,
had the
we
venue.
Had speakers, we had the venue, we had like everything, and we started so late, and we didn't expect it. Just the week we chose was the finals exams, like in UC Berkeley. So we had a lot less
people
than we expected, and at the end of the thing, but we had to cancel. But it was a great, great, great thing to do, because we tested our limits. We got to know ourselves better, and we got to know that we were able to without any money, we got to have catering and a venue and everything. So it was great.
Yeah, so it showed that you were capable.
Yes.
And then
exactly.
I guess like when you had to cancel it, it must it must have been a bit hard as well.
Yes, of course it was.
And how did you find yourself confronted to that? Like, how were you reacting to that
after that?
Yeah, or even during the experience when you were like, okay, I have to cancel. Like, were you just, okay, I have to cancel, I'll do it? Or were you like really annoyed and angry?
We had different, like, we had cycles.
Okay.
My partner and I were, when I was like, let's say it's the best thing to do, my partner was like, I'm so angry, no,
we need to continue.
Let's try. And finally at the end we were like, no, yes, it's the best, because we were gonna lose money, and finally it wasn't worth it.
Okay.
So, but yes, it was kind of hard because we worked a lot, and
it's always hard to say sort of,
yes,
goodbye
of course,
to something, but
and it must have been like, it might have been a great thing, and to get to do it was like our dream, how to say, but finally it wasn't possible, so we'll have the
and so after the 4 months at
yes.
UC Berkeley, right at the end of UC Berkeley, how did you feel? I feel like those 4 months must have been really intense as well. I mean, you're
they
constantly
were.
Working on your project, and you're constantly with your team, which sometimes can be a bit suffocating, I would say.
Yes.
So after those 4 months were done, how did you feel?
It was weird because I felt I was going back. Like in my head, it was like, oh no, I'm just taking a few weeks, and I'll be back in Berkeley and continue, and I don't know, and see all my friends over there. And but at the end, you see, like, after 2 weeks or three, it's like, oh no, it's over, and you feel a little bit sad, and especially after that, you were gonna meet your friends like in Paris and stuff, but I don't know, we were so close, and it was a great team. We got to know each other very, very good, and sharing everything, like all the time, and sharing time, and being like until late at night, working together in different groups, and sharing our experiences and stuff. It was like, I don't know, it was like a big, big boot camp or stuff. I don't know. I felt weird because I get to know a lot of people, like really, really good, and I miss them.
Yeah,
I miss them a lot. And I miss Berkeley too. I miss like all this happiness and all this like, I don't know, optimism and all this like, I don't know, strength.
You feel that Paris or Madrid isn't like that?
It's different. Like I feel it here in school that. But not in the outside. Like in Madrid, it's a little bit more difficult because it's my comfort zone, and the people I know or are not in this environment. But let's say in San Francisco, it's like everything you do is around all this ecosystem. So here you have like different you have your friends which are in corporates and stuff. It's more mixed, and there it's
yeah.
more like everything you do
and
is
it's
related.
Also it's also the ecosystem in which we were in, right?
Yes,
because you were
exactly.
in this entrepreneurship program within
That's
UC
it.
Berkeley
That's
so I guess like all the meetups and stuff that you did
exactly.
still were, you know, we're surrounding that area as well, so it must have been hard as well to sort of break away from
yes.
from that ecosystem.
I felt a little bit lost, like for a month or stuff. I felt a little bit lost because I wasn't sure. It was like I had to process all the information, all the things that I had learned and everything, and just take my time to decide which way I was gonna choose. So.
Yeah, I mean,
let's
I
say
just,
it's
yeah.
it's completely
because one thing is going to the valley for like a couple of days or whatever, and another thing is living it as an entrepreneur. I think
exactly.
those are two completely different experiences.
Exactly.
Okay, and then tell us a bit more about what you do now. What's What's happening after Berkeley? What did you do?
After Berkeley, I wanted to continue my venture, but finally I had an opportunity to launch a venture with a Spanish partner.
Uh-huh.
And right now I'm using all the things I'm learning here in School Lab to use them like in my own venture. So,
and did you feel like the stuff that you learned or like the experience that you went through in Berkeley really helps the way you you interact with your team or the way you envision certain things, the way you
everything
you act?
I am the person who the bridge made me like I cannot think about how things were before that. It's like now I think in a different way because of Berkeley, because of the bridge, because of you guys. Like you teach me everything I needed to really understand what I'm doing and really feeling that I'm part of this ecosystem.
And before we continue, guys, don't forget that you can ask any questions on the chat. I'll be here to answer you. You only need to have a Google account for you to be able to do this. So if you haven't logged into your account, just do it and ask us questions on the chat. Otherwise, you can also ask us a question directly on our website. So our email address, lebridge@theschoollab.com. So Maria, so what's you said you were launching a night adventure right now. What is it about?
It's about recycling. It's about logistics and recycling. And now a few weeks ago we presented
a project.
Yes, we presented a project for a foundation in uh-huh. Spain, and we're waiting for the
answer.
Yes, the answer. So let's
and
see.
And with that foundation, you'd be able to get capital, or
exactly.
All right.
What we're looking for right now is capital because we have everything. And we just need someone to invest in to make it real.
And in terms, because I think investors is also something very interesting. How different it is to approach mm-hmm. investors in the US and over here?
Completely different.
Did you meet any investors back in Silicon
yes,
Valley?
Yes, I can say that it's not easy anyway, like to meet investors and to make an investor invest on your venture because it's money and it has to be like your idea or your team or whatever the investor is looking for has to be like great because it's money. And if they don't believe in your idea or your team, they're not going to invest anything.
Do you feel that investors believe more in your idea or in your team when you're early stage?
More in the team. Early stage and more in the idea when it's late stage.
Later stage.
Yes.
Okay. And what about here in Paris? Have you felt like or in
here
Spain?
It's different because it, like the ecosystem there is like they move a lot of money, a lot more than Europe. So let's say the investment they're gonna give you in the States is gonna be bigger than the one you're gonna get in Europe. But in like it's different. Over there it's more like business angels and particular persons, like more like not big, big ventures. And here it's more like big corporates who invest or that invest.
Okay.
Or it's kind of the way they manage things are completely different. It's like it's not private. It kind of in the United States it's more like kind of private investment, and here it's more like maybe the state and corporate.
Okay.
And
interesting.
Yes.
And so what are your plans now?
My plans now continue to work on my venture and keep working.
Would you want to move back to the US or isn't that on the table right now?
At the beginning, I wanted to, but right now I think our customers and our clients are in Europe. So I think I'll be between Europe, in between Spain and France.
For the next couple of months.
Yes, exactly.
Okay,
exactly.
And how?
Especially in France.
Right? How do you like Paris? How do you like the ecosystem? Do you feel it's a vibrant one and dynamic and?
If I thought I found my way, my home in the United States, here I
found
I
your
say
second
yes,
home.
Exactly. Even my first, like, because I don't know, people like the culture. Let's say it's pretty similar from my Spanish one, so it's easier for us to to match, and it's not that far. Let's say that the United States, it's quite far from Europe,
okay.
So especially from Spain or France or whatever. So sometimes you feel a little bit alone
and homesick when
yes,
you're there.
Yes, homesick. And I don't know, the ecosystem here in Paris is growing like so fast, and I think it's a great opportunity to invest right now. Like having the chance to learn from the Silicon Valley, like in San Francisco, and now being here to invest,
apply as well.
Yes,
was the right mix.
Yes, absolutely. I
okay.
think like the choice was awesome, like the best one I could ever do.
Thank you. Guys, have you got any questions for Maria? Because I am on the chat right now and I'm not seeing anything. So please don't be shy. Manon, have you got any questions or?
Maybe Maria can give some tips or maybe advise people who'd like to do the program, but maybe that
yes, of course.
Who are hesitating for any reason.
Mm-hmm.
So
tips, be so open. Open-minded, open, like open to new cultures, to people who are different, to meet people you don't know, people who you might not meet in your home country. Talk a lot. Talk about your project, talk about your adventure, talk about what you do, what you like.
What about tips to find your team?
Tips to find my team. Let's say during class, during the lectures, you're gonna be learning how to like see different profiles and this kind of things. But personally, believe in yourself and follow what you think, because
follow your gut.
Yeah, follow your gut, because it's most of the times it's the good choice. So. You can talk a lot, especially during the first weeks, talk a lot with your mates, like with your colleagues. And
if you were to talk to someone right now who might be thinking of launching an idea and doesn't know where to start or what to do, what would you tell them?
To apply to the bridge.
Of course. But aside from that, what would be your tips? How do you start? How do you get...
Learn from the best ones, like read
yeah.
a lot, read the news, read from Guy Kawasaki, from read books on entrepreneurship. We had a list from different books that were like the
watch
most...
videos as well. There are plenty of great videos on
videos.
YouTube.
TED Talks.
A couple weeks ago we sent out a newsletter with what we call the hot list by LeBridge. So those are sort of entrepreneurs or entrepreneurship content that we find on the internet that we think are extremely important and relevant. And one of them is Sam Altman's set of videos. So he did a set of lectures at Stanford a couple years ago. And Sam Altman, for those who don't know him, he's the founder of the Y Combinator, based in the US. And so he has a great set of lectures on how to start your venture from scratch. So from the very, very beginning of like generating an idea to like raising funds. So I highly recommend it if you guys are struggling with, you know, where to go and what to do, or if you're stuck at some of, you know, at a phase basically of development in your project. Okay, well, you know, don't forget to ask us questions. So thank you, Maria, for your testimonial. we're just gonna quickly wrap up this webinar with a couple of information. So you can visit our website, lebridge@theschoollab.com. I'm just gonna write it right now on the School of the Con on the chat. And this is our email, which is thebridge@theschoollab.com, obviously. Yes, you know, we, Manon and I work for School Lab. I think we forgot to mention what School Lab was. School Lab, can you say? So School Lab is an innovation studio based in Paris. So we were created 13 years ago, and it all started actually back in Silicon Valley at Stanford University when one of our co-founders was doing his MBA there, and he sort of got acquainted to those new methodologies or new ways of thinking and creating projects, namely design thinking, open innovation, lean startup, and stuff that hadn't arrived to France yet. And so what he decided to do was to bring with him all that methodology and do two things: transform companies and transform education. And so what he did was one program called the CPI, Création d'un Produit Innovant in French, in partnership with three schools from three different disciplines, so designers, engineers, and business. So if you know what design thinking is, you know that those are three main pillars of that methodology. So with students from those three different disciplines, we would form teams that would work for a corporate project. So a corporate would come to us with, you know, wanting to launch a new product or wanting to rebrand an old product, wanting to invent a new tool that would allow or optimize certain processes. I mean, there are plenty of different projects. And so for 6 months, you had a team of those students working for that company and really coming up with a solution, prototyping a functional product that the company could then sort of take back and use it. So that's what School Lab was for a long time, for like around 8 years. And after that, we've expanded a lot more, always having in mind, you know, putting together people that would not have worked together otherwise. So we work a lot with corporations, with students from across the disciplines, and also with entrepreneurs. And we make them collaborate, not only during our programs, but also here at School Lab. So we have a big space, of 2,000 square meters at the heart of Paris in Sentier, 21 Rue de Cléry, by the way. And so over here, you can meet a lot of people from different backgrounds. You can meet people, employees who've been working for 15 years or 20 years and decided to quit, basically, to launch their ventures. You can meet students that are just graduated. You can meet students that are still undertaking their courses. You can meet designers, developers, architects, why not, business students, business majors. You've got a bit of everything, and everyone sort of, you know, meets under this umbrella of innovation, I would say, or not even innovation, just this umbrella of sharing experience. And then we have a side activity of startups, acceleration and incubation. So we have a couple of programs based in Paris here at School Lab that last 6 months, and they run twice a year. They're only for early stage startups. So we have a program for students, recent graduates, a program for, as I said earlier, employees who decided to quit their jobs and launch their ventures. And we also have a program for international startups. So we're able to issue a four-year visa to non-Europeans, for them to come back here to Paris and implement their business in France, but also in Europe. And then we have Le Bridge, which is the program that this webinar was talking about. So Le Bridge is a program that we have with UC Berkeley, where we send students like Maria, well, you were a recent grad, but recent graduates as well, up to 28 years old. And we send them to UC Berkeley for 4 months. Within those 4 months, they meet, they form teams, and they launch a first project or a first idea. They also have entrepreneurship courses to support their journey, and they can also take courses from the entire faculty of Berkeley. And this year, what's changing is that we're doing a partnership with 42, which is a developer school based in Paris that recently opened a campus abroad and mainly near San Francisco. So we're partnering up with them so that students will work alongside developers to really help accelerate their ideas. And then after those 4 months, if the students still want to work on their project, they are more than welcome to come back here to Paris, where they're incubated. And we help them move from the idea to the product in 6 months with mentoring, workshop, office hours with experts, and plenty of events so that they can, you know, train on their pitching skills. They can get feedback from experts. So it's a very complete program. And the dates, by the way, are always the same. So the Berkeley period runs from mid-August to mid-December. And then the Paris part runs from around February to July. So we're still accepting applications until May. The next batch will end on the 20th of April. So if you're interested by the Le Bridge, or if you want to meet some of entrepreneurs, I mean, this is just Maria, but we have plenty more downstairs actually that are working on their projects currently. So if you would just want to meet them, have a coffee with them, ask them your questions, even pitch them your idea and get feedback, don't hesitate. You can message us at lebridge@theschoollab.com, visit our website as well, and come to our events. So thank you guys for listening. It was a pleasure talking to you, and if you have any more questions, don't hesitate. So great, thank you Maria so much for your feedback and your experience. Thank you Manon for being here, and thank you guys. So goodbye. Wait, thank you. Okay, bye.